Hello, my name is Aidar, and I am representing Astana International Financial Center Authority, Department of Islamic Finance. Today, our lecture will be regarding Sharia principles in Islamic finance. So, from the very beginning, I would like to say that Islamic banking and finance is a system that operated in accordance with the Sharia. So, rules of Sharia or Islamic law, which was founded 1,400 years ago. So, what's the meaning of Sharia? And specifically in Islamic finance. The word of Sharia literally means a water hole. In Islamic terminology, it means the legal system of Islam. So, Sharia means Islamic law, and Islamic finance is known as Sharia-compliant finance. So now, let's begin to understand what is the relation between Sharia and Fiqh. Rules of Sharia known as a Fiqh, Islamic jurisprudence. Fiqh is the human understanding of Sharia. Sharia objectives implemented by rulings, legal opinions, or fatwa. Hukm, plural ahkam, is a particular rulings, legal decisions in a given case. So now we would like to speak about fiqh al-mu'amalat. What is a fiqh al-mu'amalat? Fiqh al-mu'amalat, the basis of Islamic commercial law, is predicted as a fiqh al-mu'amalat. Literally, it means fiqh of human interrelations. What we have to know about rules or ahkam in Sharia? There is well-known five principles or five rules what we should to understand and to know in Sharia rulings. First is obligatory, wajib. The second is recommended, mandub. Third is permissible, mubah. Fourth is disliked, makruh. And fifth is prohibited, haram. So, in the different case and different situation, Sharia can have several rulings depending on these five. So, in one case, some situation can be judged, or Sharia judgments, Sharia jurisprudence will have a rules as obligatory. And another, it will be like a recommended, and third can be mubah or makruh, and some of cases maybe Sharia ruling will say that this is things is haram. For example, the rule for wajib or obligatory is that it must be performed by subject and for doing, so this is will rewarded by sawab for him, while omitting it without a legal excuse entails a penalty. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, O you who believe, eat not riba, usury or interest, double it and multiply it, but fear Allah that you may be successful. So it means that Allah obligate us to do not use riba in our interrelations, in our daily things. So it means that if we should to obey the obligation of Allah, otherwise we will have some punishment from him. So the second one is mandub, which is recommended. For example, mandub is defined as demand by the lawgiver Allah for the commission of an act without making a binding or without assigning any blame for its omission. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, O you who believe, when the contract adept for the fixed period, write it down. It means mandub ruling is that for doing for this the reward for him, while omitting it entails no penalty. So doing of this is permitted, but there is no any entails and there is no any penalties. The third one is mubah. Mubah is permissible act which lawgiver Allah has granted a choice of commission or omission without blame of praise any omission or commissions. It is also called halal. So mubah that is mentioned in legal text is usually expressed in word like there is no harm for you, or it is no sin for you. So this is permissible things. The fourth one is makruh. Makruh is defined as one on which omission or demanded by lawgiver Allah is non-binding terms. An example of act makruh is indulging in trade at the time of the Jummah Friday prayer. So Allah Almighty says in Quran, O you who believe, when the call for Salah prayer on Friday come to the reimburse of Allah, Jummah and Salah prayer, so you have to leave off business and every other things. That is better for you if you did not, but no. So it means that it's better to leave everything in Jummah prayer and go to Salah. The fifth one, which is a haram, prohibited. Haram is defined in one which omission is required by the lawgiver Allah in binding and certain terms. An example of prohibited act is the misappropriation of another wealth. So Allah the Almighty says in Quran, and eat up not one another's unjustly. It means do not eat other's wealth, which is prohibited, haram. Now we'd like to speak about Sharia legal maxims. So there is a lot of Sharia legal maxims. We would like to stop on some well-known and some main Sharia legal maxims in Sharia fiqh al-mu'amalat. One of these Sharia legal maxims, al-umur bimaqasidiha. Acts are guided by intention. So it means everything what people would like to do, judged by their intention. For example, this legal maxim is a reprehensible and the reowned hadith narrated by Umar ibn al-Khattab. I heard from the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon of him, says, the reward of deeds depends upon the intention. This is in Sahih al-Bukhari. It means, for example, in Mudaraba Act, if it is intention of entrepreneur to provide the guarantee in term of the capital to capital provider, then the contract could not be recognized like Mudaraba contract, because this is against of Mudaraba spirit. The second legal maxim act is Al-Yaqinu La Yuzalu Bishaq, which is mean certainty is not overruled by doubt. This legal maxim is based on Quranic verse and most of them follow nothing but assumptions. Certainly, assumptions no avail against the truth. This legal maxim has been supplemented by a number of other legal maxims such the norm of Sharia like a presumption of innocence. Al-Asl Bara Fi Adh-Dhimma. For example, prior to the conclusion of sale contract, neither the prospective contracting parties has any obligation arising from yet to be concluded sale contract. The third legal maxim is hardship begets facility. Al-Mashaqqatu Tajlibu Al-Taysir. This legal maxim is a rewarding of Quranic verses of state. Allah exalted does not want to place you in difficulty. Or other legal maxims is necessity makes the unlawful lawful. So for example, one may argue that is imposition of ta'weed compensation has the effect of increasing the original debt and therefore unlawful because this is a riba. But this practice is however allowed based on necessity of the ground that it is necessary to punish the solvent debtor and to prevent him from delays in paying the debt. So unlawful things like increasing in principal amounts in this case become lawful. But we know what any penalties, any fines from such transaction should go to the charity. So the next legal maxims say us, al-dararu yuzal, harm should be removed. So this legal maxim has been derived from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which says, harm may neither be inflicted nor reciprocated. La dararu wa la dirar. This legal maxim has been supplemented by a number of other legal maxims, such as a specific harm is tolerated in order to prevent a more general one. Harm is implemented to the extent that is possible. A greater harm is eliminated by means of a lesser harm. So the next legal maxim say us that harm prevention should be given the priority that promoting of benefits. Dar al-mafasid awla min jalb al-masalih. When the mafasid, it means harm, and masalih, it means benefits. So when it mixed together, people are supposed to leave both of them so long as the people cannot extract the benefit solely. Sharia is very keen to encourage men to leave the forbidden things more than to do benefits. Harm may increase if it is not stopped immediately. Examples: a man is not allowed to open a window if he harming his neighbor's privacy. If there is no secure place for taking a necessary shower, a woman in Islam may postpone performing salah. There is a four well-known sources of Sharia, which is the Quran, which is mean as primary sources, Sunnah, which is the primary source as well,
Ijma, secondary sources of Sharia, and Ijtihad, which is also secondary sources of Sharia. So Quran is the words of Allah. Sunnah or Al-Hadith, saying and actions of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Ijma is a scholarly consensus. Ijtihad, qiyas, deduction by analogy. Then we would like to speak about schools in Islamic law. Islamic schools in Islam is mazhabs, and there is a mazhab Hanafi, mazhab Maliki, Shafi, and Hanbali. So for example, mazhab al-Hanafi, which well introduced in Turkey, Balkans, and Central Asia territory. Mazhab al-Maliki, well known in Western Africa and GCC countries. Mazhab al-Shafi, well known in Far East Asia, Northeastern, and Levant. Al-Hanbali Mazhab, representing in Saudi Arabia and some GCC countries. The interpretation of Sharia for Islamic finance services can generally be divided into three main parts. The first is the Middle Eastern, second is the Far Eastern, and third is the Iranian school. Nowadays, we have a certain Islamic organization which work with Sharia and giving the rules and making standards. The first of all is the IOFI, Accounting and Auditing Organization for Islamic Financial Institutions, which is responsible to make standards for accounting and auditing for Islamic financial institutions. The second is Islamic Financial Service Board, IFSB. So IFSB situated in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, and its objective to give the standards for regulatory bodies. For example, we have some Islamic academy issuing fatwa and ahkam in different cases. For example, like International Islamic Fiqh Academy or ISRA, International Sharia Research Academy for Islamic Finance. When we'd like to speak about the principles of Muamalat, we should to mention the following. First of all, freedom of contract, Hurriya al-Taqqud. The second one is freedom for price control. The third one is a risk sharing, Al-Ghunmu Bil-Ghurmi. Fourth one is a freedom for riba. The next one is a freedom from gharar, uncertainty. Also, we should to avoid hoardings. And second, avoidance of selling forbidden things, haram items. So now what we need to know about prohibition of riba. So riba is translated as a excess or unjust increments. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has defined riba as every loan that draws interest, benefit. So riba can be classified into two types, riba al-nasiya and riba al-fadl. Riba al-nasiya describes as any excess over the principal amount paid which is charged for the delay in repayment. Riba al-fadl describes an unequal exchange of sale of specific commodities including gold, silver, barley, wheat, salt, and dates. When any of these items are exchanged with the same items, the quality should be the same and weight should be the same, and immediate possession by both parties is necessary. Now we would like to speak about prohibition of gharar. So gharar is the several things including the sales, settlement risk when the seller has no control over the subject matter or not in a position to hand over the subject matter to the buyer. The second one is inaccurate or inadequate information, where the gharar is caused by inadequate and not relevant information or the subject matter or price is unknown. The third one is the gambling. So when the uncertainty of the timing of the benefits, where the transactions involve with speculation or extreme risks, hazard, it means gambling, which is also forbidden as a part of gharar.